वेरी गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन. आई रुक्षा अंसारी स्टडीइंग एमएससी माइक्रोबायोलॉजी एट वीर नर्मद साउथ गुजरात यूनिवर्सिटी. टुडे आई वुड लाइक टू टॉक ऑन अ टॉपिक दैट इज अ डाइजेशन एंड एब्जॉर्प्शन. एज वी नो दैट एनी फूड विच वी टेक इट मस्ट बी डाइजेस्टेड प्रॉपरली एंड नॉट ओनली द डाइजेशन इज इम्पॉर्टेंट बट द डाइजेस्टेड फूड शुड बी एब्जॉर्ब प्रॉपरली. सो वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द डाइजेशन एंड एब्जॉर्प्शन ऑफ अ फूड एंड वी विल सी डिफरेंट डेफिशियंसीज एंड द सिंड्रोम्स रिलेटेड विद द इनप्रॉपर डाइजेशन ऑफ अ फूड. सो एज वी नो दैट द न्यूट्रिशन इज वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर अस एंड इट इज the getting and utilization of the energy rich nutrient by an organism. Whenever we take food, it provides energy, materials for the growth, maintenance of the body temperature, as well as it helps in repairing of the tissues. The major nutrients of the foods are the fats, proteins, minerals, water, roughage, vitamins, and the carbohydrates. Roughage are the fibers which helps stomach for the digestion of the another particle of the food. The water is very important. It is playing a role in metabolic processes and prevents the dehydration of the body. Digestive system mainly involves alimentary canal and the digestive glands. In alimentary canal, which means the gut, it includes mouth, buccal cavity, salivary glands, esophagus, then gallbladder, pancreas, large intestines. Alimentary canal mainly involves the mouth, the buccal cavity, which is present over here, then the pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small intestine, and large intestine, as well as the anus. Whereas the digestive gland mainly involves salivary glands, gastric glands, liver, pancreas, and intestinal glands. Let's start with the alimentary canal. Very first, that is the mouth and buccal cavity. Mouth is helping in receiving the food, means the ingestion of the food starts with the mouth. The buccal cavity or the oral or the mouth cavity, it consists of the palate, teeth, and the muscular tongue. Palate has anterior part, that is the hard palate, and the posterior palate, that is soft. Tongue is a muscular organ attached to the floor of the oral cavity by the frenulum. Here we can see the muscular attachment is observed beneath the tongue, that is known as the frenulum, and tongue has a small projectiles that is called as the papillae, and they bears the taste buds. At the back, on the either side of the tongue, tonsils are the present. The nature of a nature and the mode of the arrangement of the teeth is known as the dentition. Human dentition have three part or the three type of the teeth, that are the heterodont, thecodont, and the diffeodont. So very first is the heterodont definition. It means the different kind of teeth present. They are the incisor, canines, premolar, and the molar. Incisor mainly involves in the cutting of the food. Canine involves for the tearing of the larger particle in the smaller particle. Premolar mainly help in the mastication, and the molars involved for the mastication. Both are the involved in the mastication. Here we can see this is the canine. Last three are the molars. The next two are the premolar, and these are the molar which are having the sharp end. Premolar and molars are collectively known as the cheek teeth, which have cusps. Here cusp means having a sharper end. It means teeth, all the teeth that are placed in a jaw socket. Here we can see these are the jaw sockets in which teeth are placed. These are the incisor, then canine, premolar, and molars. Same we can observe on another side. Then the third is a diffeodont. It means teeth appears twice lifetime. Means they are milk teeth and permanent teeth. When we concerned about the decidual teeth, that are 20 in numbers and develops at the age of 6 to 7 months. Okay, they are replaced by the permanent teeth at the age of 6 to 7 Then the permanent teeth are 32 in numbers. Here we can see that incisors are the four, means two on both sides, then canines, molars. This is the image of the milk teeth, means there are total 20 number of the teeth available. When we concern about the adult, they are having 32 number of the teeth, including premolar and molar too. The last four molar appear only at the age of 18, so they are called as the wisdom teeth. The hard chewing surface of teeth is made up of the enamel layer. Then the dental formula. When we concern about the formula, it explains the different kind and number of the teeth. The human dental formula of teeth, it involves incisor 2x2, means both, when we concern only a single side, there are total four incisors present, then canine, premolar, molar, and total 32 number of teeth observed in a human dental arrangement. When we concern about the milk dentition, they contains 20 teeth only. Then another part of alimentary canal is pharynx. It is a common passage of digestive and respiratory system. When food material pass through the pharynx, the cartilaginous epiglottis, it closes the glottis. Sometimes it pre-opens the larynx and prevents the entry of food into the trachea. What are the trachea? Trachea is mainly tube-like structure which allow the passes of the air. In the sense, this epiglottis prevents the insertion of food into the nasal cavity, into the trachea. Then esophagus, it is a muscular tube having 30 centimeter length that conducts food into the stomach. Posterior part of esophagus has gastroesophageal sphincter. Here, sphincter means a tubular lining or the ring-like structure which involves in the contraction and the relaxation of any muscle. It controls the opening of esophagus into the stomach. Here, lower esophageal sphincter can be shown at the end of the esophagus. When food is taken by the mouth, it slowly goes inside the digestive tract. This is the esophagus. This circular muscle is available at the lower part. The previous mouthful of food is swallowed when it is contracted and relaxed and helps in the easy passage of the food into the stomach. Then, esophagus connected with the stomach. Here, we can see that it is a lower esophageal sphincter which connects esophagus with the stomach. Then cardiac muscle is present. It is a J-shaped structure which store and digest food. It have three parts. Upper part is known as the fundus. Middle part, that is known as the cardiac stomach. And lower part, this is known as the pyloric stomach. Pyloric stomach leads to a small intestine by an opening. The opening of the pyloric stomach is known as the pylorus. Here you can see the pylorus, and it is guarded by the pyloric sphincter. Here sphincters are the present, means the muscles having a ring-like structure. They guard the pylorus. Inner wall of the stomach bear longitudinal folds that are known as the rugae. Then comes small intestine. It is the longest part of the gut, having 7 meter length and 2.5 centimeter diameter. It has three parts, that is the duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. Here you can see that duodenum is the upper part, jejunum is a middle part, and the lower part is known as the ileum. Small intestine, it is having a finger-like villi into the at the mucosa, and each villus has brush-bordered columnar epithelial layer which provide with the microvilli. Villus consists of capillary network and a small lymph वेसल्स. द कैपिलरी नेटवर्क मेनली इन्वॉल्व इन द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ द दिस कैपिलरी बेड. मीन्स इट इज अ इंटरवूवन नेटवर्क ऑफ द कैपिलरीज विच सप्लाइज द न्यूट्रिशन टू द डिफरेंट ऑर्गन. देन लैक्टियल इज ऑल्सो प्रेजेंट. दिस विलाई इज फर्दर हैविंग द माइक्रोविलाई विच इंक्रीज द सर्फेस एरिया फॉर द एब्जॉर्प्शन. As well as this hepatic portal vein is available, it is a vessel that moves blood from the spleen and gastrointestinal tract to the liver. Further, this lumen is a space, interior space. Then the large intestine and the anus. It is 1.5 meter long and it has three parts, that is cecum, colon and rectum. When we consider about the cecum, it is well developed in herbivorous but very small in the man. It is arising from the cecum that is known as the vermiform appendix. It is a finger-like vestigial organ. Here we can see the vermiform appendix. It is known as the vermiform because of the shape like the worm. Then the colon. It consists of ascending colon, transverse colon, as well as descending colon. The third part is the rectum. It is a pelvic colon, means the closest to the rectum and the anus. It opens in the anus and anus is guarded by the anal sphincter. Here sphincter is available which guards the anus. Then when we concern about the histology of human gut, the transverse section of human gut shows four layers. First is the mucosa, here that is the mucosa, submucosa, then the circular muscle layer which is present upper side of the nerve net. That nerve net is present between the muscle layer and this is the longitudinal muscle layer, and the last outer layer is known as the peritoneum. The mucosa is the innermost moist epithelial layer. It contains secretory an absorptive cell, whereas the submucosa, it is a soft connective tissue layer just outside of the mucosa and contains nerve and the blood vessel. When we concern about the muscularis, it is the outer to the submucosa and smooth muscle layer. It is having inner circular and outer longitudinal muscle, whereas the serosa, it is the outermost fibrous layer. One minute. Sir, is it visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So that was all about the digestive system's part. Here you can see all over the digestive system, which involves all the part of the digestive tract.
Visual3dscience.com.
So let's see, this is the whole digestive system of a human.
Okay.
Then let's take closer view of this stomach cut. This is a stomach cut. We can see the interior part of the stomach in it.
Yes.
Then the next is intestine, colon. We will see the colon. It is having the three parts, right? All can be visible over here. This is about the villi that is present in the intestine. Closer view of the villi. This is the pancreas. We will see it in detail about it later in salivary, in a different digestive secretory gland. And this is about the liver cut. Okay, so let's continue. So we have done with the digestive tract part. Let's continue with the digestive gland. So digestive glands, they secrete digestive juices for the digestion of the food. There are total five number of the digestive glands present, that are salivary gland, gastric gland, liver, pancreas, and intestinal glands. So first is the salivary gland. It is having position in the mouth. We can say there are three pair present of each, like the parotids, that is the largest salivary gland seen in the cheeks. Here we can see this is a parotid which is present near the cheeks. After that, the submaxillary gland. Submaxillary glands seen lower the jaw. Here we can see the submaxillary gland as well as sublingual gland that are seen below the tongue. Here we can see the sublingual gland. These are the duct, mean the vessels or the tubes or the connections of different gland with the surface. So salivary glands secrete saliva, and the saliva secreted by the salivary gland contains 99.5% of water, mucus, and enzymes like salivary amylase and lysozyme, as well as the electrolyte. These electrolytes are mainly involved in the buffering of the saliva in the oral cavities. After that, the gastric glands. It is a tubular gland found in the inner wall of the stomach, and they secrete gastric juice having pH of 1.822. Then the gastric glands consist of three kind of the cell, that are the mucosinic cell, chief cells, and oxyntic, that is the parietal cell. Here we can see that the mucus cell, chief cell, and parietal cell. The mucus cells, they are the mucosinic cell. They mainly secretes the mucus and bicarbonates protects the stomach wall from hydrochloric acid and prevents its autodigestion. Whereas the chief cell, they secrete the proenzymes like pepsinogen and prorenin and some lipases. As well as the oxyntic parietal cells, they mainly secrete the hydrochloric acid and castle of intrinsic factor. This castle of intrinsic factor mainly protects vitamin B12 from the digestion in the gastrointestinal tract and facilitates the vitamin B12 absorption into the ileum. Then third digestive gland is the liver. Liver is the largest gland, having 1.5 kilogram weight. It is having reddish brown color and it is bilobed. Bilobed means having two lobes on the both sides, the large right lobe and small left lobe. Here we can see that small lobe as well as the large lobe. That's why it is known as the bilobe. Each lobe is formed of a structural and functional unit called the hepatic lobule. A lobule has many hepatic cells arranged as a cords around a central vein. They secrete alkaline bile juice. Liver lobule is covered by the Glipson capsule. Here we can see that it is a hepatic lobule. The larger view shows that it is having a central vein. And the connective septum means the wall-like structure. It is known as the Glipson capsule. There is no another class detail about present about the Clipson capsule, but it is named after the scientist who has discovered about it. When we focus on this hepatic lobule, it is having a bile duct, hepatocyte, then central veins, portal vein, hepatic artery. When this hepatic artery, portal vein, and bile duct put it together, the whole structure is known as the portal triad. Then it is also having sinusoid. So it is all about the liver. Now we will see the how bile transported from liver to the duodenum. So very firstly, bile will come from hepatic duct to the gallbladder and cystic duct. Duct is nothing but it is a tube-like structure which connects each organ with each other. Then it will flow towards the common bile duct and further passes through the common hepatopancreatic duct. This is a common hepatopancreatic duct. This is common hepatopancreatic duct, and at the end it will transport it to the duodenum. Now the pancreas, it is the second largest gland seen near the duodenal lobe. It is a cream colored heterocrine gland. Why it is known as the heterocrine? Because it has both exocrine as well as the endocrine part. The exocrine part has a pancreatic duct that opens into the duodenum along with the bile duct, and exocrine part secretes alkaline pancreatic juices. It contains inactive protease enzymes which involves trypsinogen, chymotrypsinogen, procarboxypeptidase, amylase, lipase, and the nucleases. When we see the portion of pancreas, it is having duct, delta cell, RBC, pancreatic acini that is known as the exocrine, beta and alpha cell, and islets of the Langerhans. Then the intestinal glands. It is a simple tubular gland. It is having two types, crypts of Lieberkühn and the Brunner gland. The crypt of Lieberkühn is consists of mucus secreting goblet cell and enzyme secreting Paneth cell, whereas duodenal glands confined to submucosa of duodenum which secretes mucus only. Here we can see the location of the goblet cell, blood capillaries, intestinal crypts. Intestinal crypt is known as a crypt because it is having a narrow structure which open up into a swollen structure. The crypt simply says that a narrow organ or the structure which opens up in a larger structure. Then villi is also present, the duodenal gland, submucosa as well as the muscularis mucosa is present in the intestinal gland. After now we will see the whole digestion process of food from this digestive tract. So the digestion is a conversion of the complex insoluble food material into a simple and absorbable food. It includes the mechanical processes like mastication means the chewing process, deglutination means the swallowing. After the chewing process, the chewed food is swallowed, and peristalsis means wave-like movement of food bolus through the gut by the muscular contraction. Means there is a contraction occurs for the easy passage of this chewed food. Then digestion in the buccal cavity. As we know that digestion starts at the initial stage when we take food in our mouth, right? Only starch digestion is observed in the buccal cavity. Then ptyalin, that is the salivary amylase, converts starch into the polysaccharides, right? About 30% of starch is digested by the ptyalin, that is the salivary amylase. Starch is converted into the maltose and isomaltose and dextrins. Then the digestion of food in the stomach. Stomach stores food for 4 to 5 hours, and it mix with the gastric juice by churning movement, and it convert it into the acidic pasty form. In the presence of hydrochloric acid, inactive pepsinogen is converted into the active form, and then only this pepsin will help in the destruction of protein into proteases and the peptones. In infants, we can see that in the presence of hydrochloric acid, prorenin, that is the inactivated form, is activated into the renin. In the presence of this activated renin, casein, that is the milk protein, is converted into the paracasein. And in the presence of calcium, paracasein is converted into the paracaseinate, that is the curd. And this CA paracaseinate, calcium paracaseinate, means the curd, is converted into the peptone with the use of the pepsin. The gastric lipase hydrolyze a small amount of the lipid. This is a digestion of shown in the stomach. After that, the digestion in the small intestine. So the digestion in the small intestine mainly occurs in the duodenum. Chyme is the mix with the bile juice. Now the food which is digested till now, it is known as the chyme, that is mixed with the bile juice, pancreatic juice, and intestinal juice, that is the succus entricus. Here, succus entricus is mainly named for the various enzymes like the lipase, lactase, enterokinase, amylase, and the mucus. Furthermore, the fat globule is connected with the bile salt, emulsifying the fat droplet. Here, bile helps in the digestion by the emulsification, means the conversion of fat into the mucil. And
your voice is not
okay.
Coming.
So, conversion of fat into the micelles and the tiny droplets. This provides large surface area for the action of lipase on the fat, and bile also activates the lipase. As we know that this is a larger molecule of the fat, so it is not easy to digest it or absorb easily. So, here bile salt, which are having hydrophobic part and the hydrophilic part. So this bile salt attached from the hydrophobic part with this fat globule. They are simply a fat loving site, and then it emulsifies the fat droplet and convert into the small droplet, which is easily digested. Now the action of the pancreatic juice, enterokinin, that is the enteropeptidase present in the intestinal juice, activates the trypsinogen to activate the trypsin. Here enterokinin mainly activates trypsinogen into the active form trypsin. This trypsin active chymotrypsinogen into the chymotrypsin, and further this trypsin also activates procarboxypeptidase into the activated form, that is the carboxypeptidase. Protein, peptone, and proteases are converted into the dipeptide in the presence of this carboxypeptidase. Fats are converted into the diglycerides and the monoglyceride in the presence of the lipase in the small intestine. Now the action of the intestinal juice. At duodenum, intestinal enzyme act on those product like dipeptidase mainly act on the dipeptide to form amino acid. Maltase acts on maltose to form it to convert it into 2 glucose molecule. Lactase convert lactose into the glucose plus galactose. Sucrose is converted into glucose plus fructose in the presence of sucrase. Then nucleotidase mainly converts nucleotide into the nucleosides, and further it can be converted into the sugar and the bases in the presence of the same enzyme. Diglycerides and the monoglycerides are converted into the fatty acid and glycerol in the presence of the lipase. So that was about the digestion in the small intestine. Function of the large intestine. As we know that in large intestine, there is no significant digestive activity is observed. In large intestine, mainly absorption occurs. The absorption mainly involves the water, mineral, and certain drugs absorption. The large intestine secretes mucus, for adhering waste particle together, lubricating it for easy passage. Fully digested semi-fluid and alkaline food in the small intestine is known as the chyme. Now, as we know, the digestion is occurred, but the proper regulation is important too. The digestive activity like the gastric and intestinal secretion are the controlled by the neural and hormonal mechanism. The sight, smell, or the presence of food in a buccal cavity stimulates the salivary secretion. The gastric and intestinal mucosa secretes digestive hormones. They control secretion of the digestive juices. After the digestion, absorption of digested product is important. So the absorption of the digested product mainly involves different different ways, like it can be active or the passive. In passive passage, it involves the osmosis or the diffusion, or diffusion can be simple or the facilitated. Here we can see this is a lumen of the gut. Glucose, galactose, fructose means all the digested particles are the here. They must have to be absorbed by the different capillaries, and the surface of the digestive tract for the proper getting nutrition, right? So here we can see the glucose, galactose, amino acid, dipeptide, tripeptide. They are transferred to the capillary of villus, but the long chain of fatty acid is transported into the lacteals, because these lacteals are having larger pore size than the capillary of villus. So the passive absorption, here we can say there are molecules that are transferred from the higher concentrated region to the lower concentrated region. That process is known as the diffusion. But if this process is mediated by another protein or the another molecule that are embedded into the cell membrane, passage is known as the facilitated diffusion. Absorption of nutrient from the higher concentrated region to the lower concentrated region without the expenditure of the energy, that is known as the diffusion. Diffusion can be of two types: the simple diffusion, in which molecule alone can be diffused, and in facilitated diffusion, diffusion with the help of carrier protein is achieved. When we talk about the active absorption, it is having the phenomena where the molecule is passed from the lower concentrated region to the higher concentrated region with the help of the ATP. It needs ATP. Examples are the absorption of amino acid, monosaccharides like glucose, electrolytes like sodium, etc. Now, the absorption of lipid. Here we can see that fatty acid and the monoglyceride leaves the micelle, enter the epithelial cell. Means they are normally present in the lumen of intestine. After the emulsification, they formed in the smaller part. They are converted into the smaller part. The smaller part are transferred into the epithelial cell, that is the absorptive. Fatty acid links together to form triglyceride. These fat globules combined with the protein to form chylomicrons, and these chylomicrons are extruded from the epithelial cell and it's entered to the lacteal. As we know that the fatty acids are having a chain-like structure, it is having a larger structure, it cannot be easily absorbed by the villi. So lacteal is important for the absorption of the lipid. Absorption in the different part of the alimentary canal. From mouth, we can absorb different certain drugs. Stomach involves the water, simple sugar, and some drug and alcohols absorption. In small intestine, all nutrients, including minerals and vitamins, are absorbed. And large intestine mainly involves the water and some minerals, which are left to be absorbed by the small intestine, is absorbed. So the small intestine is the chief area of the absorption due to the presence of villi, its large, its great length, and the coiled nature. Absorbed materials are incorporated into tissue for their activity. It is known as the assimilation. Undigested substances like plant fiber, dead bacteria, etc., form feces. It enters cecum through the ileocecal valve, which prevents the backflow of the feces. Feces are temporarily stored in the rectum and are eliminated through the anus. The process is known as the egestion. If the digestion and absorption is not properly done, so there can be different disorder observed, like jaundice. In jaundice, skin and eye turn yellow due to the deposition of the bile pigment, and it indicates the liver damage. Ejection of stomach content through the mouth, it is controlled by the medulla oblongata, that process that is known as the vomiting. The medulla oblongata is a stem-like structure which regulates the various function, which also includes the vomiting process. After that, the diarrhea, it is another disorder related with the digestive system. It is a frequent elimination of watery feces, and it reduces the absorption of the food. Here we can say that in normal condition, food absorption is done properly, but in diarrheic patient, we can see there is no proper absorption is occurred. Then the constipation, it is infrequent elimination of dry stool, and it is due to the decreased peristalsis in colon. Peristalsis is a process which involves the movement, continuous movement, which helps the easy passage of the food through the digestive tract. After that, indigestion, it is a condition leading to failing of fullness due to improper digestion, and it can be occurred due to the anxiety, inadequate enzyme secretion, food poisoning, and engulfment of the spicy food. These are the another disorder which involves the protein energy malnutrition, that is PAM. It is dietary deficiency of the protein and food calorie. PAM causes the marasmus and kwashiorkor in children. Marasmus, when we talk about the marasmus, it is due to the deficiency of both protein and the calorie, and it is found in infant less than year in her age. Reason is that replacement of the mother milk by the food with poor protein and caloric value, and this happens if mother has second pregnancy or childbirth when older infant is still too young. Then the symptoms of the marasmus is impaired growth and the replacement of tissue protein. Then extreme emaciation of the body, thin limb, dry, thin and wrinkled skin, declined growth rate and body weight, impaired growth and development of brain and mental facility. The next disorder of the PRAM due to the protein energy malnutrition is the kwashiorkor. It is due to the protein deficiency only, and the reason behind it is replacement of mother milk by high calorie, low protein diet in a child more than 1 year in age. The symptom can be seen that marasmus, like the marasmus, is so wasting of muscles, thinning of limb, failure of growth and brain development. Unlike the marasmus, some fat is still under the skin, extensive oedema and swelling of the body part. Due to the deposition of the fat, the body part can be swallowed. So that was all about the digestion and absorption. Thank you.
Good, very good.